committee to order. We want to thank everyone and welcome you here tonight. Public comment is welcome. Anyone wishing to speak on any item on the standing committee agenda may do so when the item is up for discussion. You will have up to 3 minutes to state your comments. Please come forward to the microphone and you will be recognized. For recording purposes, we would ask that all present speak directly into a microphone. Roll call.
Roll call. Bryant?
Here.
Philbrook?
Here.
Markley?
Here.
Kane?
Here.
Johnson?
Here.
Bynum?
Here. And next we have approval of the minutes. We have minutes from our June 22nd and July 20th meetings. Is there a motion?
Second.
Motion and a second. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And the minutes have been approved. This takes us to our committee agenda. Item number one on this agenda is a request for an honorary street name at 6th and Quindaro to read Reverend Willie W.C. Vaughn Jr. Avenue. I have had a request that this item be deferred to our next monthly standing committee meeting. If I could have a motion to defer this item. We have some concerns. I do not personally, but there has been brought to me some questions and concerns, and I don't think it's a big issue. I think it's just a matter of answering questions.
So moved that we put it to next month.
Second.
So I have a motion and a second to defer the item 1 month. Roll call on that motion.
Roll call. Bryant?
Aye.
Philbrook?
Aye.
Markley?
Aye.
Kane?
Aye.
Johnson?
Aye.
Fine.
Aye. I would like to say if anyone in the audience is present on that item and you would like to make any comments, you would be more than welcome at the podium. And you either can or choose not to come back next month. I would invite you to come back next month as well.
Good evening. My name is Latoria Chin, and I am representing tonight. I have my Evangelistic Center hat on. Usually I have my Kansas Speedway hat on, but tonight it's Evangelistic Center. This will be the second delay.
Correct.
For some reason. If there are any questions that we can answer about renaming the street after our founder, please feel free to ask me.
Let me just share with you that Commissioner Townsend, it is in her district.
Mm-hmm.
She doesn't serve on this committee. She
mm-hmm.
had some questions that she wanted answered, and unfortunately, I was only made aware of that a day or so ago. So she wasn't able to be here, and she has made that request, and I'm going to honor that since it is
certainly
in her district. I apologize for the further delay because I know that last month we bumped you to this month.
Yes.
So I would like to hear just a little bit about the documentation that you gave us in the packet, maybe for the public to know about the honor that you're trying to bestow on the Reverend.
Sure. In about 3 minutes, our founding pastor was Superintendent Willie C. Vaughn Jr., and this is our church's 50th year anniversary, so we are trying to get the founding physical spot where the church was founded, the street named after him. We are now located at 1800 Washington Boulevard, and our founder's mm-hmm. son is mm-hmm. our pastor, Bishop Jack Vaughn. And we have been working on this, I guess, since the spring, and we had to get formal documentation to you that we did, and then we had to also send out some packages of approval because some of those neighbors were not responding.
Okay.
So after we did that, and that was accepted, the packages that went out, so we've done everything that we can do in order to get this done.
Okay.
We were on the agenda last month. We were bumped to this month, and now we're being bumped to next month. So I'm just not sure.
Last month's agenda only had your item.
Right,
and we
understand that. But just a few minutes about our founder. 50 years ago, he did found at the church with maybe 10 members. It is now a two-service, a Sunday membership with maybe approximately 850 persons. here in Kansas City, Kansas, and in the metropolitan area, coming as far as from Belton, Lee Summit, Blue Springs. He had 10 children who are all very active. Three now are deceased, but the remaining seven have PhDs, EdDs, just the whole works. So we wanted to honor him and his wife. His wife is still living. She'll be 92 on her birthday. And we just wanted to let the community know and let you know, let everybody know just how special he was to us and how we want to rename the street. Well, the street is somewhat on some property that we own, mm-hmm. and there's no houses, there's no buildings, it's just grass right now, the street that we want. So not sure of the holdup, but we can only wait until
just a quick question
another month.
Sorry to keep interrupting.
That's okay.
The North 6th Street goes north about two or three blocks, do I have that right? Before it turns and goes east and becomes what, Greeley? Or does it continue north?
It continues north.
It does.
Actually, where the church was, which is no longer standing, that name or that street has been honored, Reverend Higgs.
Okay.
So we could not use that. So we went a block east, which is still deemed 6th and Quindaro, to name that street. So
well,
that's where
we are. I appreciate you being here.
Mm-hmm.
If you are able, we will be in touch with you about next month's agenda. If you are able, please come back.
Do you know what day it will be?
We can know what day before you leave here today.
Okay.
Today is, I believe, the fourth Monday, and I'm not sure if that's always the schedule or not. Someone can help me, I'm sure. Does anyone know?
We're actually trying to get this done because it is the 50th year.
Correct.
So we would love to put this among the items that we did during because we've been celebrating since January.
Excellent.
So we want to celebrate until December.
Yes.
But
if we're down for October the 19th right now.
October 19th.
So we will.
And then from here it has to go to the full commission, right?
It probably is changed because we're having the strategic planning that day. Now that I look at this.
Whatever Monday it falls on, mm-hmm. that immediate Thursday, I believe, will be the commission agenda it's on. So I believe that'll be conducted in 1 week's time.
Here's 26th
of October on Monday the 26th, and then it would be full commission the same Thursday of that week.
Okay. All righty.
So thank you.
Thank you.
Commissioner Johnson?
I would just add the current location is in the 4th District, and they are certainly an asset. I knew Pastor Willie C. Vaughn personally, and so this is certainly worthy of the honor that they want to bestow up him. I hope that, and I believe that, all of whatever the issues are will be quickly resolved because it's certainly something that is worthy to happen this year.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Item number two is a resolution authorizing a survey of land for pump station 30 Force Main replacement. We have Public Works here. Lori, I don't know if I will pronounce your name correctly. Hello. So we have Bill Heatherman and a colleague who I do not know, I apologize, here to present.
Thank you. And this is Lidiana LaBoy, our city traffic engineer.
Hello,
Lidiana.
We
will be back next month for the street name signing.
Thank you.
And if Lori wants to come up here, this is basically a standard part of the beginning of all of our projects. It just gives us the authority to undertake the surveys and legal work necessary if, in fact, we should need to use condemnation for easements, but we have a negotiating period that always precedes that. And with regards to this particular project, it's a force main repair. We're just now beginning the design, just now beginning to look at the alternatives. We have done some interim repairs, but we know we need to make a permanent improvement. And with that, we could stand for any questions.
Commissioner Kane?
When you guys, just one minor thing, can we put the address down or the close proximity to where these are? I wouldn't know where pump station 30 was.
We can, do we have the address of what's closest to pump station 30?
You don't have to have it tonight, but the next time we bring one on, let's get a close proximity. You guys, the way you look at things,
we can do that, Commissioner.
Different than the way we look at things.
We can do that, Commissioner. No problem.
That question came up in agenda review, and although it's not on the request for action, I think the The item on the agenda is 3300 North 85th Street, 85th Place. South 11th Road.
Okay, I see it. All right, move for approval.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Roll call on the motion.
Roll call, Bryant.
Aye.
Philbrook.
Aye.
Markley.
Aye.
Kane.
Aye.
Johnson.
Aye.
Vinyl.
Aye. Motion passes. Item number three is a presentation from our police department regarding tow lots.
While they're walking up, I would remind everyone the game starts at 7. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Mr. Criswell. So we have joining us Captain Dungan and Jenny Myers from Legal, and I believe Gordon Criswell with our county administrator's office is going to start this.
Well, I'll just start by introducing these guys, which you've already done. They've got the PowerPoint ready to go.
Okay.
And, so Captain and Jenny, I'll turn it over to you all.
How are you doing?
Good.
I'm Captain Dungan with the police department. I used to be working in the bureau, and the bureau captain over property is in charge of the tow lots through the police department. So me and Jennifer used to meet with the tow companies, and several years ago we talked to Sharon, who was also part of that meeting, about this, and then it kind of evolved to this, and I was asked to look into it, so that's where we're at now. So we're going to talk about, this is currently the three tow companies we have and what parts of the city they work. All Star, All Allen, and All Allendon, and All City. Their contract, they, what has it been about?
Captain.
Could you pull the microphone a little closer,
I'm
please?
Sorry. I think this contract is about 3 or 4 years old, right? Four. So this is currently the number of tows that between us and the Sheriff's Department do per year. We average about 5,000 tows a year. So currently, a lot of the problems we're having is that the tow companies don't meet the contract, and there are several issues. One is they're required to have 2 acres of storage. One of them currently does not. Hard base surface, one of them doesn't. The response times, none of them have complied with that response. With that, none of them meet that requirement. The towing of one vehicle at a time, none of them do that. Several of them have one tow truck pull up. It takes 2 vehicles. The air conditioning, the heating inside the buildings where we store our cars that we put police holds on for when CSI comes down and processes them, victims' cars. One of them doesn't, none of them are truly secure. Some of the complaints that we've had from the tow company is that they don't have enough tows for it to be profitable for them. Currently, one of the things they do is that if you have your car towed by the police department and it is on their lot, and you want to have that car towed from their lot to your house, they will now charge you $50 for that tow truck. They'll charge the company $50 to pull on their lot to hook up that car and take it off their lot if they can't prove workman's comp insurance. This is an incident that happened in one of our tow lots where the victim was down there picking up his vehicle, and he's watching through the fence as the employees of the tow lot were rifling through his car and stealing property out of his truck. Once they saw him watching them, they threw a lot of the property back in the truck, and then one of the employees approached him, and he was wearing a necklace that was stolen out of his truck, and when he confronted the guy said, well, I found it on the ground. We talked to him and see if he wanted to press charges. He refused. He was just happy to get his truck back. The biggest problem we've had is in the customer service area. We're currently, if we have a hold on a police vehicle, they have to come to the police department or the sheriff's department to get it released before they go to the tow company, so they got to go to 2 different locations. They have to, victims' cars being released on police holds. We've had several that were on police holds that have been sold in the auction before they were released. They do not allow people to go through their vehicles and recover property. Like if somebody has pictures of their child or school books or something like that, they won't let them recover that property. We've had several vehicles that were either stolen or have a lien holder out of another jurisdiction. Two of the companies currently do a nationwide search to see if they are if they're stolen or have lien holders. One of them does not. So a lot of cars that are sold in the auction, when this person goes and gets a tag or something like that, it comes up stolen. So then Jennifer has to get involved and turn it over to a judge to say, hey, he legally bought it, but this car was stolen. So the car goes back to the tow lot. It's on hold until a judge makes a ruling on whose car it is. We had one incident where the judge ordered, well, if you get a tow, you can go through a tow hearing. And if a judge rules in your favor, that you're reimbursed for the tow. Judge Ryan put out a court order ordering the tow company to reimburse the party. After several months, it took him several months to reimburse the party for his money, for his tow. These are the three tow lots, and they're in-store storage for our police vehicles. Currently, they don't do background checks or driver's license checks on the employees. Allendon's to your left. The truck to your left, red truck back there, the top left picture, was a vehicle that was used in the Ward's car lot, where they were breaking in Ward's car lot. And then the bottom one is this Crown Victoria that was used in the homicide, vehicular homicide at 3rd and James. They run a muffler shop in the same building we have our police vehicles on hold. Here at All-Star to your right is also an unsecured building. All the employees have access to these vehicles. The green vehicle to your top right, the white SUV in the back, them are the vehicles from the homicide at 19th and Quindaro that their employees have complete access to. It's not secure. So that's one of the big issues I've found. Solutions. If it was a police or city ran tow lot, the vehicles would be secure. All our employees for the police department in the city have background checks. We run driver's license checks every 6 months on our employees. Victims will only have to go to one location to pick up their property. One of the problems we have is our auctions for the property out of our property room. We send it to an online auctioneer when we could use that. When we have their auctions that auction the property out of vehicles, they could do that also. Two of the employees that we currently have under that are work for the city that we're paying that do the releases on the vehicles could be moved to that location to release the vehicles. We could reduce the fees for victims. All the companies I've talked to that have city ran or police ran tow lots waive fees for victims on most issues. Their vehicles won't be sold at the auctions because we'll know they have holds on them. We'll be able to, most of the companies allow people to come and remove property out of their cars. And the compliance with the judge's rules in a timely manner. Currently reduce the tow companies to two. They would get reimbursed for every vehicle instead of now where they only get paid for so many vehicles. They'll get paid for every tow, or if they get called out, they get canceled, they get paid for that. You know, if you're making 5,000 tows per year, that's an average of $250,000 for each tow company per year. And the internet access, they're supposed to have internet access. The police department has access to watch the lots. One of them does not have that currently and has been very reluctant to let us do that. So what I did was I just put a circle around Kansas City and I picked 20 cities in that circle, and out of 50% of them have city ran police tow lots. And this is a current list of the ones that did. I visited three of them and I've talked to the other ones on the phone. And the tow lots are self-supporting, they run themselves.
Does anybody have any questions for the presenters? Yeah. Commissioner Philbrook?
I have several.
Okay.
So are you suggesting that we have one tow lot, or are you suggesting we have a tow lot and two others?
I'm kind of confused.
My suggestion is a police-ran tow lot, and then you use the tow companies to bring the vehicles to the tow lot.
Okay. Okay, I was trying to understand exactly where you were going with that.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you, I appreciate that. And what do you consider the appropriate response time?
Currently, our response time is 20 minutes, and most of the ones that I've talked to, it's about 30. Missouri's response time right now is 6 minutes.
I've heard that they have a lot of tow trucks around running around over there. Anyway, okay, so their response time is 6 minutes. Well, I'm not looking for that.
No, not at all.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. And you feel that a half an hour is definitely way too long?
I think
Or is that in our codes? Or?
Well, it's in the contract right now. It's 20 minutes. I don't think 30 minutes is too long. That's what most of them are.
Well, the reason I asked that is because we have run into some situations where we have people that work for tow companies who their bosses are telling them that they have to keep their tow trucks at home because they don't have time to run down and grab the tow truck and then get there. And so that is a concern. That part of it is a concern. So I just thought I would bring that up. Mm-hmm. Because the people would like to stay in their homes and not move. But on the other hand, they have to have a job to pay their rent or whatever. So I just wanted to bring that forward.
Commissioner King?
Where are we going to put the cars?
That, once we get past this, they were talking about looking for locations for that.
And surely we don't do business with the one that was stealing out of the people's car anymore.
That's the one we're talking about not renewing the contract with.
Well, I agree with everything you've said so far, including not using those guys anymore.
Mr. Bryant.
You talked about two employees being like the release agents for the vehicles, but would there be 24/7 coverage?
For that part of the job, it's going to be an 8-to-5. Now for working behind the tow lot, it'll be a full coverage, but for them two jobs, it'll be 8-to-5.
Okay, so it'd be open. The lot would be available to tow trucks.
Right.
24/7.
Yes. Right.
Commissioner Johnson.
Are you suggesting or recommending that we look at doing a city-owned lot as opposed to renewing these contracts that we have right now? So within the next 8 months, we might be making a transition. Is that what the request is?
The idea, because this is going to take several years to do. This is not something we can do in 8 months. And what we talked about was keeping the contract, because we can extend the contract year per year with the tow companies we have, and keeping extending it for however they want, with the two or three or however they want to do it for now. And then
the contract that we currently have was a 5-year contract, so it will expire in May of 2016.
Right.
So that's why we're starting to look at this. If the commission decided for us to look at this, what he's saying is this wouldn't be done. We'd have to make, Mr. Bach would have to determine, you know, where to move in the next year or so as far as the contract and extending it. So this is looking down the road.
So a question, when you renegotiate contracts that would be basically short term, would that be open to any lot, or would you restrict? I guess this would be a question I would ask for more information on later, perhaps. Would that be something that would be open or restricted to only the ones you currently have contracts with?
That would be a conversation with administration.
Okay.
To see how they would like to handle what we're going to do in the interim.
I do have a question and or a request. Is there any way that you can include in that employees who work at these locations be vetted appropriately to do that kind of work?
I think we could add that as a term, yes.
Okay, I'd appreciate that.
Okay.
Commissioner Merkley. Just one point of clarity, because I think this can be confusing and goes to the, you know, the point of the contracts. We would have our own tow lot, but we wouldn't have our own tow trucks, so no matter what, there would still be contracts with the tow truck to bring them to our lot.
Yes,
yes. Does that
correct
make sense?
Thank you for clarifying. This would only be about the tow lots. One other question. Kansas City, Missouri is operating their own tow lots?
Yes.
And can, do you know for how long they've been doing that? And can you tell us, is it a successful operation?
They have a they have a lot down there that's huge, and they're paying right now about $1.7 million on that lot to pay it off. And in 7 years, when it's paid off, Missouri will make about $2.2 million per year on off their tow lot.
On the tow lot, thank
yeah.
you. Does anyone else have any? Yes.
Has there been any, and I'm sure the answer is no to this, but I just need to ask it for the record, has there been any cost analysis done up to this point for this?
No.
Okay. So there are a lot of moving parts that still need to be uncovered, but it sounds like the general direction that you all are recommending is that we would look into having our own tow lot as opposed to the way that it's done right now. Second question is, when you, as you all have been undergoing this analysis, have you uncovered any cons as to why we would not move away from this current structure?
The biggest benefit that I've seen is, like I said, I talked to 20 different companies. If currently, if you get your car towed in Independence, Missouri right now, and you're a victim, it's like your car gets stolen, it's recovered over there, no matter what, it's going to cost you $285 to get your tow out. Now that's, and every tow city that I've talked to that does not have a city ran tow lot, that's what it is.
Okay.
You got to pay Johnson County, you got to pay the tow. There's no waiving of fees, none of that. You got to pay the tow to get your vehicle. I don't think that's right.
Anything else from the commission? Chief Ziegler, thank you for joining us. Do you have anything you would like to add?
Nothing that I can think of.
Okay.
I'm good.
Okay, thank you. Does anyone from the public wish to address this item? If so, please come to the microphone. State your name and city of residency for the record, and you will be given up to 3 minutes. Welcome.
Hi, Mark Sales with Midwest Tow Service here in Wyandotte County. We've been a tow company here for about 30 years. We're currently not on the contract. I would just suggest to you guys, you know, to take in consideration companies like us that do try to do it right or do it right, that, you know, if you're, it may take several years to do what you're wanting to do. And if you have a few companies that, you know, aren't doing it good, that maybe you do a 1 year or 2 year contract to let, you know, other good companies in there to do it for you. So just keep that in consideration.
Thank you.
Because we've been kind of prepping for, you know, trying to get this, not bid, but, you know, to be able to put our hat in the bid. And now because of a few tow companies, you know, not doing it right, kind of spoils it for everybody.
Thank you. Appreciate your comments. And this presentation was for information only, so there's no action on this tonight, yes? Oh, hello.
Hi. Elnora Jefferson, Kansas City, Kansas. And the comment that I have doesn't deal directly with tow lots, but about 4 years ago, I was doing some research, and what I discovered was that in the state of Kansas, say, for example, a tow operator has gained title to a vehicle because the owner did not pay the fine and claim it. Then the tow company was allowed to sell rightfully, and that's how it recouped the money owed. But what happens is that if the amount of money that the purchase price is greater than the cost, then that was a profit for the tow company. And that has to do, or at least it was not clarified in Kansas state statute, whereas in Nebraska and Oklahoma, they did it differently. So it's just a comment then that as far as looking into this, it would be, would the police department do things differently rather than making a profit off of the owner's vehicle? So, thank you.
Thank you. Okay, and again, thank you for those from the public who shared your comments, and this is an information-only item, so I'm sure we'll hear more as you progress through this project. Thank you. And our last item for this meeting is the 2015 fireworks report presented by Fire Marshal Zimbelman, and Mr. Zimbelman is here from the Fire Department. Welcome.
Good evening.
Good evening, and the floor is yours.
This is a summary of the 2015 fireworks report. This includes six departments throughout the unified government. This is just a slight overview. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer any that I can. This report is from June 29th to July 5th. The fire department responded to 21 fireworks-related calls. That's approximately 35% down from last year. Of these calls, we have them broke down. If you'd like them broke down, I can just give you a final figure on them. The approximated cost to the fire department was $5,623. Be in mind that this does not include wear and tear on vehicles, point of readiness, or manpower cost in within those calls. We also are going to include next year the amount of burn injuries that are possibly missed by the EMS service and or usually transported by POV. We've met with KU, Providence, and Children's Mercy, and that way that'll give us a little better figure on the true effect of the fireworks in Wyandotte County. I spoke with the police department. The police department this year responded to 248 911 calls. 189 of those actually were coded out as fireworks-related calls. In these calls, they weren't specific on the number of citations that were issued. We're trying to get those figures for next year's to make sure that it's a little clearer on that. Public Works, their total cost this year was $41,931 for those 5 days. That being, again, broke down by cleanup and street closures and miscellaneous items. Air quality was also contacted. Air quality, the only day that we had any issue with air quality was on the 4th. They showed a excess of 44.5, which is exceeding the 24-hour standard. It only exceeded it for 3 hours, and that was basically the peak time, went from dusk till 1 o'clock. During that time, we only had two areas in the city that were truly affected. That was the downtown area and a little bit of the southern area. The southern area only lasted for approximately, they thought, around about an hour. So it was a very short period. Sheriff's Department reported no tickets and no fireworks violations this year. They only had 6 fireworks warnings in the parks. And code enforcement reported that we had 49 total stands this year. License fee on that was $54,325. That was up two stands, and we are also looking at different ways to increase the fees, hopefully within the next few years, to the bigger vendors. That's the conclusion of that report. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer what I can.
Questions? Yes, sir.
Well, it's not so much a question as it's just general comments that, you know, when you look at it after you take the amount of dollars, the revenue from it versus the cost, leaves about 7,000 left. You figure that you have, you know, the labor and licensing department, record keeping, legal, police dispatch, 189 calls, the labor there, $7,000 I'm sure doesn't really cover. You know, I'm not against the idea of fireworks being allowed in our city, but I wouldn't be against the idea that the fees for the stands go up considerably. I mean, 25 to 50%, figuring that you're looking at about a little over $1,000 average for a stand right now. Even at 1500, I doubt that would limit the number of stand applications you would get, because they're very profitable businesses.
As we speak right now, we're trying to figure out a new scale plan, and the scale plan, hopefully we can get before the commission sometime at the first of the year to raise the fees, and because this doesn't, it leaves a large gap, and especially the amount of what they make by their end total. So hopefully we can come up with something that's a scaled plan, and it'll greatly affect everybody for paying what they should pay.
All right. Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Do you have any data that shows where in the city the majority of the stands are and where the majority of the fireworks are, for lack of a better term, popped?
Popped is all over. the greatest majority of your stands, if you take 635 and go four miles on each side of it and go a straight strip down the middle of KCK, that's your stands.
On both sides
on
of
both
635.
Sides. Yeah. Okay. That's going to be a majority of your stands. State Avenue is the highest concentration as you go west. The further you go west, of course, the stands decrease, but there is a large number of stands between 38th Street and 78th Street.
Commissioner King.
I don't know where they buy them, but they pop them all over by my house.
Yeah, they are. Thank you very much for the data. It's very much appreciated. Is there any member of the public that would like to comment on the fireworks report information? And I will just note, this is an annual report that the fire department brings to us every year, and we very much appreciate all of your work. Thank you very much. It looks like we have no public comment. And that item was for information, and with that, there are no further items on this agenda. That concludes this meeting. Thank you very much, fellow commissioners. We are adjourned.
And I think we published for 5:45, am I right, Gordon?
That's correct.
So we will have a 5-minute break before the next meeting begins.
That's the one thing it doesn't tell me is what time we published.
Coming up on UGTV, standing committee meetings of the Unified Government of Wyandotte County, Kansas City, Kansas. We begin with a meeting of the Public Works and Safety Standing Committee. This will be followed by the Administration and Human Services Standing Committee.
Administration and Human Services Standing Committee to order. We want to welcome everyone to this meeting. Public comment is welcome. Anyone wishing to speak on any item on the Standing Committee agenda may do so when the item is up for discussion. You will have up to 3 minutes to state your comments. Please come forward to the microphone and you will be recognized. For accurate recording purposes, we ask all present to speak directly into a microphone. Would the clerk please call the roll?
Roll call. Philbrook.
Here.
Johnson.
Here.
Kane.
Here.
Bynum.
Here.
Markley.
Here. A blue sheet has been distributed this evening providing additional information for an existing item on CDBG. Next, we have the minutes from our June 22nd and July 20th meetings. Is there a motion for approval?
Move approval.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Those minutes have been approved. That takes us to item number one in our committee agenda, which is the removal of the user login requirement. Presentation by Mr. Chris Cooley from DOTS. Chris?
Hi, welcome. Thank you, Commissioners, for letting me talk tonight. This is a for information only item. Wanted to bring a policy change before you. Staff has had the discussion with administration. Administration recommended we make the change. Legal has suggested that we, you know, at least vet it with the administration standing committee to let you guys know of the policy change that's occurring. Current policy is that users using our public website when they're doing searches and inquiries on real estate and similar information must have a user login and be logged into the system and in order to see owner name and address of that public information in order to see that when they're doing a search from outside the UG. Future policy that we're recommending with this is to remove that login requirement. Currently, the login is kind of a barrier, kind of cumbersome to the occasional or casual user. My staff and the staff of the clerk's office frequently get questions for who owns this property, and the question that comes with that is, can I do this online? Well, the answer to them is yes, but you've got to jump through these hoops and create a username and login. Further reasoning for doing this, making this policy change, is that a review of other agencies around us, other counties, other cities that provide information like this on public website, they have no longer had this requirement as well. So you can do a search by owner name, you can search by parcel number or address and see who the owner of the property is on those other agencies' websites. So recommending that we make the same change here as well. This also would save staff time in that we can refer people to that are so willing to to self-serve, and many people are happy to do that in today's age. We're certainly willing to help those that call us and that don't have the computer savvy or the time to deal with the computer maybe. But those things are the positive benefits of it. What does this policy impact? It impacts the searches that the public is making on the YouTube website. What it doesn't impact is the standard Freedom of Information Act requests or the Kansas Open Records Act requests. Those are still handled in the same way, same manner, and that somebody would need to submit us a request, explain the record that they're looking for, and we would provide it to them in a timely manner with our standard policies that we do that with. This also doesn't impact those individuals that have opted out under Kansas statute. Members of law enforcement, judges, city attorneys, and you know, other members of public safety that have sensitive jobs, that would be concerned about their privacy. Their information is removed from the public search on the website if they have requested it. And we've recently, I believe in January, we received about 250 requests from our police department. And there's other people that have made requests that have been the appropriate person under the statute to make the request to be removed from the public search. So that's the impact of the policy. And wanted to, once again, inform you, the commission, that we're making this change. Unless there's a strong heartache or concern that's raised here, at which point we would go back and reconsider it. But at this point, I'd give it to you guys, see if you have any comments or questions.
Commissioner Philbrook.
I have a comment. It's wonderful. Thank you. Because not too long ago, we talked about this a little bit.
Yes.
And expressed to you that we would really like the public to be able to get to this information. And so thank you very much for following through.
Any additional questions from the commission? Does anyone in the public wish to speak on this item? Thanks so much, Mr. Cooley, for presenting today.
Thank you.
Item number two is in regards to the farmer's market process and fee structure. Rob Richardson, our planning director, is here to present this item. Mr. Richardson.
Thank you, Commissioner. This is a request for approval to move forward and develop a new ordinance and administrative policy related to farmers markets. The current ordinance has two different sections that deal with farmers markets. One is under the special use permit and the temporary use of land section. So you all see several special use permits that are temporary uses of land for commercial or industrial purposes and are familiar with that. The second is under the accessory uses in the agricultural district. If you're raised products on site, you can sell them on site. That's common across the state. And secondly, in the commercial districts as accessory uses, you can have exterior sales. It doesn't specifically say agricultural products, but they would fit in that category. So what are our issues? Most of our farmers markets operate under a special use permit. And that is that temporary use of land special use permit. We have a little bit of an issue between local and imported foods. And so local, we would define that in the future, but it's somewhere within 100 to 150 miles of us. Not cantaloupes from California or, you know, grapefruit from Florida, things like that. The SUP process takes 60 to 90 days, and the fee is $350 every other year to go through that process. So our proposed revisions would be to define both farmers market and local food, to amend the zoning code to allow farmers markets as an accessory use specifically in agriculture, all commercial, all industrial, and the traditional neighborhood design or T&D zoning districts. We would create an administrative process for approval of the local produce farmers markets, reduce that time frame to be under 2 weeks, and reduce the fee. The fees are set administratively for these type of processes, but I'm thinking somewhere in the $50 a year range for the fee. Then we would require a special use permit for non-local produce if it continues to be an issue as we work with the local growers, and I anticipate that it will. And then also if you were going to do something in a residential zoning district. That's what I would propose to do. We would work that through the Planning Commission process, and it would come back to you after the Planning Commission saw it.
Commissioner Bynum?
I may not have this right, but it was my understanding that part of the issue we were dealing with regarding current farmers markets was the need for them to comply with whatever zoning was present on the spot they were in, such as commercial and number of parking spots, et cetera, et cetera. So this doesn't fix any of that, does it?
Well, yes, it would. Okay. We're working on an application, an administrative application that would address those things. And having adequate parking will still be one of those that's important. But we can, you know, certain commercial parking lots, for instance, you would know are only full, you know, from November, Saturdays in the first week of November through, you know, first week of January or something. And so there's extra room. Some of them there aren't, you know, if it's a restaurant, then some of those are, you know, full different times. So we can work through some of those issues, and this would allow us to have the flexibility to do that. Whereas right now we could just say no. I mean, all we can do is say no. So I think it will give us more flexibility with those.
Okay.
And it will give us some better enforcement because there have been people selling at 38th and State, and I can tell they probably don't have a business license. They don't have, you know, they're probably not collecting sales tax and other things that this would allow us to make sure we enforce uniformly across the city.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions from the commission?
Just a comment.
I appreciate you doing this because we have a big push to make this community greener and to have a lot more people doing the produce and selling it. And so this will open it up and actually make it cost effective for them to be able to do it versus have to come before us and pay $350 right off the get-go. So thank you. Mm-hmm. Thanks for going this way.
Are there any comments from the public on this item? Rob, this says it's for information only, but then you have direction to staff. It sounds like there's consensus for you to move forward. Do you want a motion, or are you good to go?
As long, why don't you do a motion just to be safe?
I move that we follow this direction.
Second.
We have a motion and second. Can we have a roll call?
Roll call. Philbrook.
Aye.
Johnson.
Aye.
Kane.
Aye.
Bynum.
Aye.
Markley.
Aye. There you go, Rob.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Item number three is an update on billboards, and Mr. Richardson will continue his comments in that vein.
Thank you. So we have 8 digital billboard permits. Those are listed up on the screen with the addresses. As you'll recall, last spring we amended the outdoor advertising, technically the outdoor advertising code, to allow digital displays instead of static displays under certain criteria. 2 of them have been fully completed, permits 4 and 5. The others are delayed from a combination of the state permitting process and equipment delays and overseas shipping. But both companies that are doing these anticipate that they will be complete by the end of the year. One of the requirements was that they remove urban billboards at a ratio of 1.5 or 2 to 1. And so each permit, and you have this in your materials that were provided in the packet, each permit and the billboards that will come down related to that. You'll notice that these billboards are already down, but it's really only one sign for each board. They were double-faced sign, and they took down, Lamar didn't have a lot of urban boards to take down, so they took down actual large billboards, and they took down 2 faces of billboard in 2 different locations there. So those are the signs that are to be removed. And as I said, you have that information in your packet. Oops. Since the sign companies anticipate being completed by the end of the year, I'll do another update when everything is wrapped up in February or March, depending on when I get the final notices and affidavits that all of the urban boards have been removed based on the digital boards being installed.
Questions from the commission?
Robert, are these the only 8 billboards that we'll have in Wyandotte County?
Those are the only 8 that are currently permitted, and the two companies that were most interested in those digital billboards indicate that these are the only ones that they anticipate for some time. There are a couple of other companies around, but it would be a challenge for them to meet the takedown requirement. They would have to give up space to be able to do that. Now, they might do that, but they haven't informed us that they will.
I'm sure you know the criteria that is utilized to determine where signs are established at. And I'm just wondering what criteria basically is utilized or to justify these spots versus other spots.
Well, that's based on the marketing information of each individual company where they would put the digital display. And they will tell you that sometimes they get it wrong and they'll put one up and it doesn't work there and they'll take it down and move it somewhere else. So it's just the company's marketing. And it also has to meet they're converting an existing board. So all the existing boards are either legal or legal non-conforming, and they have the right to change one of those boards if they meet the other criteria related to the takedown and the business license fees.
Additional questions from the commission? Are there any comments from the public on this item? Thank you again, Rob. Item number 4 is a discussion on CDBG reallocation and the grant application process, and Wilba Miller is here from Community Development to present this item. Welcome, Wilba.
Hi.
Yes, Commissioner?
For the record, I do not believe this belongs in front of this committee, and I want everyone to know it.
Thank you very much.
During the budget process, the commission asked me to come back before the commission to talk about the allocation of funds and the application process and to give you updates on the current acquisition, rehab, and reconstruction activities that are going on. And in your packet, you will find that there are 5 items. And I'll just kind of really quickly go through the first 3 that are informational only, starting with the project that's considered now to be called Highland Crest. in the budget process, you might have heard it called District 6 Project. The timeline that had been given to commission has now been updated to include all of the 2015 information. Wells Fargo has donated a piece of property and through the land bank, and we've accepted it, and we've gotten keys for it. Last week, Mario Escobar of Argentine Betterment Corporation, or ABC, came in and picked up the keys and is starting the scope of work to get on that project. That'll be the first house for that project. We're still in the contract phase of that. We have a couple of agreements over at HUD that they need to review for HUD lease purchase and purchase of those properties. The second project is the Argentine Betterment Corporation project located at 1351 South 26th Street. This was originally a acquisition rehabilitation of a multifamily structure that was changed to a acquisition possible demolition of the structure during the budget process. We did amend our consolidated plan. Unfortunately, this project had some environmental issues, the main one being noise from the railroad tracks and from the highways, and we've worked with HUD, we've worked with commissioners, we've met with environmental people, and we could mitigate the noise. However, it would be so costly that it would not be an effective use of CDBG funds. We sent a letter and met with Mario Escobar the 18th, I believe it was, of September, and told him that we would deny the project because of reasonableness of cost. The next one was the Argentine Highland Crest Economic Development Project that was discussed at the last two budget workshops for the UG. We had received an application in February. The CD Budget Committee at that time put some money aside in June for that activity. The full commission reduced that fund, that $500,000 fund, to $400,000 with $100,000 moved to the home repair program. And then at the July 30th meeting, they reduced it an additional $50,000 for doing rural works for a total of $350,000. Those funds do need to be allocated because they were reclassified from the ABC project to redevelopment, housing, economic development, bricks and mortar to be allocated. Which brings us to the application process. The budget department prepared an application form 2 years ago that was very generic and doesn't really work for the intricacies of community development projects. Staff and I have met and started researching other cities, and in your packet you'll see a draft of an application with various cities listed on page 2 that says that we've checked with cities in Wichita, South Dakota, just different cities that had these online and available to us. This particular draft application is nice in that it contains 5 sections for different eligible activities under CDBG: housing, economic development, public services, so that if someone was to come in and wanted to apply for something specific, they could, and only fill out the generic parts and then that particular section of the application. Secondly, in that same packet, we have an attachment called Managing CDBG. It is the actual HUD document about pre-award assessments that we should do on any proposals we take, as well as application information on what we would need for their review. I feel like I'm going too fast. Sorry. The last thing is a proposed CDBG application calendar. We do have the $350,000 from that one that I just talked about available, and the $258,000 from the Argentine ABC project for a total of $608,000 that needs to be allocated. We would like to use the calendar that's in here, and we would need commission direction tonight on presenting a final version of an application to you in October, issuing a request for proposals in November, receiving them by December the 11th, giving staff until January 16th, or the next time you meet in January, to vet them and bring a spreadsheet with recommendations. One of the reasons why this is important is because HUD does a timeliness evaluation of us every August. We, this year, did not meet, but hurriedly scrambled to meet our application, timeliness issue. So we would like to get started early into the process and have these awarded by January, or and in the January meeting.
So that was a lot of information. I'm going to kind of reiterate where we are and what WILBA needs from us. So we got an update on a few projects and where those stand, but basically for the purpose of reminding us that we now have $608,000 that need to be allocated. In order to allocate those funds, I think everyone agrees we need a better application because the application we're using just didn't provide enough information to our applicants. So staff has provided us a draft application, and they are looking for us between now and next meeting to provide any feedback we have to make changes to that application so that in October we can get this process rolling, because it's important for our HUD money that we spend it promptly, so we want to award it as quickly as possible. So with that reiteration, are there questions about our situation or the application for those of you who might have taken a look at it prior to today, or the direction going forward?
Well, I'm glad that it's clarified that this is something that we have a little more time to look at, first of all.
I thought it's very simple. It's a little one-page tiny diagram. For those of you in the audience, it's quite the packet. So
specifically, when we got it, I think, just 2 days ago. So I'm not a speed reader. And so just for clarity purposes, that what we're talking about applies to this $608,000.
Correct. And I think the idea is it would be used going forward year after year, but we'd like to get it moving in particular to allocate those dollars.
First of all, yay, Turner Highland Crest. It looks like house number one. That's awesome. And that is the 2014 monies, and things are underway, and that's really great. Wilba, I appreciate the application, even though I do also understand it's a lot of paper to slog through, but this is kind of where I was. And I appreciate that you've gone out and looked at what other communities are doing with their CDBG dollars and how they're taking in their applications, and you've made sort of a hybrid, it looks like, of that. So I think that's great. I had one more thought, and I don't remember what it was, but maybe we'll come back to it before we get out of here for the Chiefs game.
Commissioner Philbrook.
Thank you. Does this mean that then, and I don't think I heard you say it, but that mean that we can make the determinations of this CDBG money, take that away from the time that we have to spend on planning for our budget, because we know about what we're going to be making, and so we don't have to spend a bunch of time down in the weeds, right, as some people like to call it? And
this would streamline the budget process.
Yes, you're exactly right. We hope that we would then be doing this application process separately from the budget process.
Yay.
To be incorporated into the budget, of
course.
No,
I understand. But, yeah. I understand, yeah. But not the decision of where it goes.
Commissioner Kane, did you have something?
Well, and I'm glad you said that, because that's one positive I've seen in this. And the rest of it, I still think it should go back to a three-person committee. You know, And maybe remove one person, put Melissa on the committee, and then, because those are the specialists. We're not a specialist. My district's not going to get this monies, you know. And I just think this was a bad choice of committee to put it on.
Commissioner Bynum, did you remember your final
Yes,
thoughts?
Thank you very much. The only question I had, and now I've done something to my computer, so I can't see where I was, but the timeline was. RFP to go out.
If we brought a application back before you in October and you approved it, we would actually go out the week of November 2nd, start the marketing of, or the advertising of the proposal.
Okay, so basically a 5-week window here. RFP out December 11, applications back in. And my question is around the marketing piece of that. So Commissioner Kane is volunteering me, and I'm volunteering myself. Okay. If you've brought a list, great. we can talk about it now, we can talk about it later. The marketing is a big deal to me. Thank
right.
you.
Do you want me to go ahead
sure.
and make a comment or two?
Yeah.
We always market or advertise our public hearings and the regular budget process in the following: Echo, Call, The Globe, Dos Mundos, KC Hispanic News. We also put it in the e-news and the UG website. We inform livable neighborhoods of it, and they send it out, and we inform our homeless agencies. However, we've decided to add Wyandotte Economic Development Corporation, the United Way, the Chambers of Commerce, obviously the commissioners, and our housing development organizations.
And I'd like to say Wilba had that list in mind just for you, Commissioner. She was ready to go. Are there additional questions from the commission? Are there any comments from the public on this item? I must say, I hope there is a Chiefs game every Monday night, because I think it sped us along quite nicely. There are no other items. We are adjourned.